Lorraine Cox was a 32-year-old woman from Devon in the UK. She had been living in Scotland with her fiancé, but had been going through some tough times, and was missing her friends and family back home. So she decided to move back to Exeter in Devon for the time being. At around 1:30 in the morning on September the 1st, 2020, Lorraine was making her way back home. She had been spending some time with her friends and the group had been out drinking. It's reported that Lorraine had consumed quite a lot of alcohol. In the days following the night out, Lorraine had conversed via text messages with her friends and family. Although, they noticed that the way she was speaking seemed somewhat strange. It almost seemed like they were talking to a different person. And then out of the blue, Lorraine sent a message to the people close to her, telling them that she was moving to a city called Plymouth. Lorraine's fiancé Elsie was constantly trying to get a hold of her, and Lorraine just simply replied with a middle finger emoji, and this was very out of character for her. After this strange behaviour, Lorraine's family and friends became greatly concerned for her well-being. Either something was seriously wrong with her, or someone else was in possession of her mobile phone. Either way, they knew they needed to do something. Lorraine's family reported her missing to the police on the 3rd of September. Lorraine was a type 1 diabetic, and when the police searched her home, they found that she had left her insulin kit, something that she couldn't be without for a long period of time. The police spoke with her friends that were with her that night, and they were able to find out the route Lorraine would have walked home that night. They then checked some of the CCTV cameras and made a chilling discovery. As Lorraine was walking home, a man could be seen lurking, following her for over a mile. This man then approached her and sparked up a conversation. The two could then be seen walking together. The hunt to find this man was now on. By the 8th of September, the police had found who they were looking for. CCTV inquiries led them to a man who lived above a kebab shop named Azam Mangori. At first, Azam told the police his name was Christopher Mayer. He said he was a gay man who had sought refuge in the United Kingdom, as this would have been punishable by death in Iraq where he was from. He had applied for asylum in 2018 but was rejected. So, he made his way to the United Kingdom illegally and arrived in the back of a lorry. Initially, Azam was charged on suspicion of kidnap. When the investigators discovered he had used Lorraine's SIM card in his mobile phone. But this charge would soon change when the police made a grim discovery. The day after his arrest, the police searched the alleyway behind his flat and found the dismembered arms and legs of Lorraine. Azam was now charged with murder. Officers also found Lorraine's rucksack, clothing, and phone, all thrown away in the alleyway. Lorraine's cut-up driving license and bank cards were discovered in Azam's kitchen bin, and her SIM card was found in the drain beneath the building where Azam was living. Detectives then discovered he had taken a taxi to a forested area called Tin Pit Hill, and there they found the decomposed head and torso of Lorraine. The body was too decomposed to determine the cause of death, but it appeared that she had been killed by asphyxiation. Azam's phone was examined, and they found a recording of himself and Lorraine having consensual intercourse down an alleyway. And when the cameras around his flat were reviewed, they found him dumping the remains. When questioned, Azam gave his version of events. He claimed that Lorraine had died in an accident, and that he didn't know how to act or what to do. He told investigators that he saw Lorraine walking alone at night and that he had begun to chat to her. Azam said that he and Lorraine got along very well. As they were walking home, they took a turn down an alleyway. He told the police he recorded the encounter in case any allegations were to occur later on. After the alleyway, Azam invited Lorraine back to his place and the two began drinking. He then told investigators that she pulled out a black substance wrapped up in tinfoil from her pocket. She then began heating it up with a lighter and inhaling the fumes. Azam said that he tried this mysterious black substance. After he did, he said his head began to spin and it made him nauseous. It then made him black out. When he awoke, he claimed Lorraine was laying unconscious on the ground next to a patch of what appeared to be urine. After not being able to wake her, Azam said he checked her pulse, which he could not feel. He says it's then when he began to perform CPR. The investigators then asked why he didn't call an ambulance, to which Azam claimed that he didn't know how to call an ambulance. He then told investigators that he began hallucinating and that weird creatures began crawling out of Lorraine's mouth. So when this happened, he put a t-shirt in her mouth as far as he could to stop the creatures from crawling out. Azam then said that the next few days after Lorraine passed away were hell, and that he went into a strange mental space. He said that when he was dismembering the body, he believed he was only chopping up wet tobacco that he had been storing in his flat. The investigators noticed several inconsistencies with his story. A toxicology report showed that Lorraine had no drugs in her system. The police also found videos on Azam's phone of him smoking a vape whilst listening to the song Chop Suey by System of the Down. He had sent this video to some online friends and recorded the video while Lorraine's body was just a few feet away on his bed. Throughout the video, he looked very calm and relaxed and did not appear to be in a hellish mental state like he claimed. Azam said that the videos were to cheer him up and to get him out of the depression he was feeling at the time. The police also found it strange that he claimed to be in this delusional state, yet he was able to hack into Lorraine's phone and message her family with coherent messages. Azam had also sold a keyboard to someone who came to collect it from the flat, again, while Lorraine's body was in the other room, and the person who bought the keyboard said he appeared to be calm. Azam had also looked at amputation videos in the days before Lorraine's disappearance, and his Google search history also showed searches on how to dig a grave by hand. He was also captured on camera in shops buying supplies to help him dispose of her body, including bin bags, tape, a suitcase, and an air purifier. After a week of leaving Lorraine's body in his flat, he eventually dismembered her, put different parts into taped up bin bags and disposed of them. He had even gone as far as to cut and remove a section of tattooed skin which indicated Lorraine was diabetic and could have helped to identify her. Here in this footage on screen, we can see Azam with a large backpack. It's likely that inside that bag was some of the remains of Lorraine. It's always deeply disturbing to see something like this on footage, and to think he would have walked past people going about their business, with no clue that they're walking past a murderer with a dead body in their bag. With all of this combined, it seemed like Azam was lying through his teeth, and that none of this was an accident, but instead, a planned and calculated crime. The trial would soon begin. Azam told his version of events that I just described to the court, and none of which seemed plausible. The prosecution team gave their theory of what occurred that night. They firmly believed that Azam had lured Lorraine to his place with the intention of killing her. The fact that he had followed her and stalked her for a mile before making contact supported this theory too. And how Azam acted and the decisions he made after the death of Lorraine were not the actions of someone who had awoken and discovered an overdose. The leading theory is that shortly after stalking Lorraine and inviting her back to his room, they had intercourse a couple more times, and then Azam pinned Lorraine down and either strangled her or used her t-shirt to asphyxiate her. He then used her phone in an attempt to misdirect those who were looking for Lorraine and to get away with the crime. Azam kept Lorraine's decomposing body in his house for days before disposing of her, and used air fresheners to cover up the smell. He then hacked Lorraine's body into pieces, removed the tattoo, and dumped her remains behind the alleyway and in the woods. Azam pleaded not guilty to murder, and was adamant that he was not responsible for her death. He said he did not remember sending the messages to Lorraine's family, but he did admit and pled guilty to preventing the lawful burial of Lorraine. Azam also recognized in court that Lorraine would have laid in his bed with him after he killed her, and that she would have been there for some time with him. All the while, he was sending videos of himself to his friends. The trial lasted for a total of 5 weeks, and Azam was found guilty and was sentenced to 20 years in prison. A punishment that I find far too lenient.